Now we will study the lesson Income Management. In this lesson, you will study about what is a family income, the different goods and services available to the family, the expenditure pattern of a family, the ways of recording the expenditure pattern. We will also study about different savings and investment avenues and the role of financial institution in saving for a family. Now let's understand family income. Income means anything which comes into the family. Income for a family comprises of money, goods, and services that are available to the family to fulfill its needs and desires. Money. Money is the hard cash you get in hand. Salary, rent, interest, income from household production are the ways by which you get money. These are the different goods. For example, car, and these are the different services. Needs. Needs are deficiencies which must be fulfilled. Food, clothing, and housing are therefore your basic needs. They are the needs which help you survive. Desires. When all your needs are fulfilled, you begin to think of meeting your desires. What you desire is not really needed to carry on life, but still you wish to have it. Expenditure. Expenditure is the money spent on buying different goods and services required by the family. Preparing an expenditure plan. The money income to be divided into various areas of expenditure such as food, clothing, housing, education, etc. Money left after primary and secondary needs are met, then one can think of fulfilling some desires. Desires will first include some comforts for one's life. While your present needs and desires are being fulfilled, you also need to think of your future needs like future purchase, retirement plans, your travel plans. Now let's understand. What is income management? Income management is the planned and controlled use of the family income. The income needs to be spent in a way that money is available for expenditure throughout the month. This process of distributing money over various items of expenditure is called income management. Process of income management. Planning. The use of family income is the one step and controlling the use of family income. Maintaining a record of income and expenditure. One simple way to have control could be to maintain a record of the income and daily expenditure of your family. Now, income and expenditure can be recorded as explained in this table. We have to record the date, the income, total income, item to be purchased, quantity of the item to be purchased, the rate, amount spent in rupees, and total balance in rupees. We have income and we have expenditure. For every family, there is a source of income, and for every family, there is a source of expenditure. For daily record of income and expenditure, what we are supposed to do is, we have made few columns. First is the date, income, then item purchased, quantity, rate, amount spent in rupees, and balance. First, you're supposed to write the date. Suppose on 1st of the month, you have bought something. Your income is, suppose, I've just mentioned here XYZ, and your item purchased is, suppose you have purchased a cloth. Now, the quantity of the cloth is 1 meter, and suppose the rate is 60 rupees per meter. So, total amount you have spent is 60 and you will write here 60. So, date wise, whatever expenditure you are doing, suppose on the second day you have spent something on buying a refrigerator. Now, refrigerator is a big item. So, item purchased, you will write refrigerator, quantity 1, rate is suppose 15,000, amount spent is 15,000 and you will write the balance is 15,000. So, this way you are going to do daily for 1st, second, third, fourth, fifth, for every day throughout the month, you have to record the expenditure and income which is coming. Suppose somebody is salaried, so her income will be monthly, and somebody who is not earning through her job is having his own shop, then he will record his income on a daily basis, whatever he is saving through the shop daily.
Here Meghna, I have a query, like every month I get short of money. So I find it a very tedious process of writing everything, all expenditure on daily basis. So is it possible, like, you know, instead of writing it daily, we can write it at the end of the month and then compile our expenditure?
You can write in the end of the month, but it is important if you maintain it daily, because then you can check where you are spending, and sometimes we are spending on unnecessary things. So we can have a check on that. So it is important to maintain a daily record of your expenditure.
Another thing which I was thinking, that do we have to write all our expenditure random, or we have to categorize our expenditure on the basis of the items that we purchase, like food items or electronic items, yeah, or travel expenses?
We are going to that. So Pratima, we have a weekly record of income and expenditure. Previously we have done for daily record. Now weekly record of income and expenditure, we have certain categories. Income, total first is we have to mention our income. Suppose day one, second day, third day, fourth day, what income you are getting. If you are salaried, you will get on the first day of the month, or maybe you get a salary on the fifth day of the month. But if you are self-employed, you may get off and on different dates. The categories are housing, the utilities, like for paying for gas, for paying for electricity, water bills. Then you have household maintenance. You have repair work in your house for plumbing, etc. So food, how much you are spending, whether you are eating the food at home or you are eating food outside. Transportation, while traveling, while going to the college, while going to your school, while going to the office, or while going to the market, how much you are spending on transportation. Medical care, in case you are sick, you need to visit a doctor, how much you are spending. Credit payments, you have certain payments to be done for different bills. Insurance, we all have insurance policies for education, health, life. So whatever we are paying, clothing and personal care, how much you're spending on clothing, personal care, all these things will come on, like toiletries, your soaps, and education, the fees which has to be paid for your children, when it is to be paid, and recreation, entertainment, you're going out for a movie, you're going to a picnic, so when you are going for that. Now, one way is while you're doing it, you are writing. Suppose housing, I'm paying the rent on 5th of day, I'll write 5th of the day, I have paid 5,000 rupees of rent. This is after I have paid. Before going to that, we can have one more step is, I know my monthly income, and I know, suppose my monthly income is 10,000 I have written here, and I know that I have to pay a rent on the 5th day, which is rupees 2,000. Same ways, I know every day my food expenditure is going to rupees 300. Now, I need to have a check on this, ki my monthly salary is 10,000, my rent is going 2,000. Same ways, I will have education, I will have insurance to be paid. So you can mention in this when you have to pay the insurance. Suppose your premium is due on the 7th of this, so you can tick on 7th, you have to pay insurance. And this can also act as a reminder, so that you can check towards the end how much you have paid and what all payments are pending. And once you have paid, you can always tick, and you can keep a check on the expenditure. One is before spending, you maintain a record. Another is while you are spending, you keep noting down whatever you are spending in utilities category, whatever you are spending on food, on which day of the month. Then this is your weekly expenditure. This is for 1 week. Same ways, you can have multiple copies of this, and you can make you will have 4 papers for making a budget for a month. And the last column, as you can see, is finding out the balance, which is total income minus total expenditure. Now, as I told you, we have a limited income and expenditures can be unlimited. So we need to find out whatever is the income, suppose housing, how much I've spent, how much I've spent on this. You will have the total of all this. And once you have the total of all this, from the total income, you will minus total expenditure and you would get the balance. At times, it may be happening that your expenditure is more than your income. In that case, you need to keep a check on where you are overspending. If you are overspending, you need to cut down on those activities.
So Meghna, I also want to ask, is this expenditure plan for a family or for an individual? So if it is for a family, do we need to write down income of all the family members or it is for a single person?
See, basically the record has to be maintained by a single person, and in that person is supposed to write the income from all the family. We are making a budget for a family. Suppose in a family there are four members, so the person who is in charge of maintaining the record will be writing the income of the four members.
Okay.
She will be asking what all the four members have spent on. So everybody has to report to that person. One person has to be made in charge for recording this income and expenditure. Now after weekly, we go on to the monthly record of income and expenditure. Once you have these sheets of weekly for 7 days, then another next week 7 days, so you have for the entire month. After that, you need to put whatever you have spent. First is your planned. Before this, we have planned how much we are going to spend on food, how much we are going to spend on education as per our income. So first stage is that we have the data for the planned expenditure. Then once we have spent, we have the data, actually how much money we have spent on these categories. We'll write those amounts spent here. And in case we are spending more, the expenditure is more than the income, then we will revise our expenditure. We will keep a check. We have the planned data here. And suppose my income is, again, I'll take example of 20,000, and housing I'm paying rent is 5,000. And suppose my rent is again 5,000 after revision also. Utilities I'm spending 2,000, and household maintenance I'm spending 5,000. Recreation is something, suppose I'm spending on 2,000. Now, if my budget is exceeding, my expenditure is going high. So when I'm going to revise, I will make sure that I cut down on my recreation. Because whenever you have to cut down on expenditure, you have to make sure you cut down on the items which are not that important to you. You can't cut down on food. You can cut down on eating out. But basic expenditures you can't cut down. So whenever you have to cut the basic other extra expenditures. So that's how you're going to make a balance again of total income minus total expenditure. Advantages of maintaining record. It helps to understand your expenses, to know exactly how much is being spent on what, like on clothing, on home, on food, on entertainment, travel, etc. Compare the expenditures of different months. If your expenses for this month are higher than last month, you will know exactly where and why you have spent more. One must check unnecessary spending. A look at the balance figure will remind you to spend only on what is really needed by your family. One should remove the unnecessary expenditure. We need to plan for the future. Regular maintenance of accounts makes it easier to know how much money would be required for the various items in the future. Be well informed of market trends. The rate column shows you when and how prices rise in the market. Different ways of supplementing income. One can adopt any income generating activity, like while working in a jute industry or through farming, or take a part-time job in neighborhood, like selling newspaper or teaching in a school. Investing savings to earn interest. Make wise use of available resources. Savings and investments. Money from the present income that is put aside for emergency or future use is known as savings. Need for saving. We need saving for a secure future, for meeting emergencies, for fulfillment of family goals, to raise the family standard of living, for starting a small business, or for self-employment. Guidelines for saving. Have a realistic saving plan. Have a regular saving plan. Be clear about the purpose for saving. Now let's understand investments. When savings are made to grow, it is called investments. Role of financial institutions. They keep your money safe. They make your saved money grow by paying interest. You can withdraw your savings as and when you need them. They give you loans against your investments. Different common investment avenues are bank, post office, provident fund, life insurance company, unit trust of India, stock exchange, private company, property or jewelry. Banks. Money not required immediately can be saved in a bank. Post office. One can also save money in the post office. One does not have to pay income tax on the interest earned on its schemes like National Savings Certificate, NSC, Indira Vikas Patra, etc. Provident Fund. To protect the salaried people in old age after retiring from service, the government has introduced a retirement benefit scheme called the Provident Fund Scheme. Main features of Provident Fund. Every month, a certain percentage of the basic salary is compulsorily deducted from the employee's salary. This deduction is a contribution towards the fund. An interest is worked towards the contribution in Provident Fund. The money deposited and the interest on it are both exempt from income tax. You can take a loan against the money deposited. A record of the contributed money and the interest earned on it is maintained by the employer. A copy of the same is also given to the employee. Types of Provident Fund Schemes. General Provident Fund, called as GPF. This is suitable for all salaried people. If desired, the employee can increase the contribution towards the fund. At the time of retirement, the employee gets both the contribution and the interest in a lump sum. Public Provident Fund or PPF. Any self-employed person can open this account with the State Bank of India or the post office. The money may be deposited either regularly in installments or in lump sum. After 5 years, the investor can take back certain percentage of this money. The investor also enjoys income tax relief. Loan can be taken against the money invested in PPF. Insurance policy. Insurance is a means of providing security against loss caused by natural or man-made factors. When one takes an insurance policy, one has to enter into a contract with the insurance company. Under the contract, the insured has to pay a sum of money known as the premium periodically to the insurance company. In return, the insurance company makes good the loss suffered by the insured person or agrees to make a compensation for the loss incurred. General insurance. This covers risks such as theft, fire, flood, drought, or any other contingency. The contract is generally made for a year. The insured has to pay the premiums periodically. The amount of premiums to be paid will depend on the amount for which the contract is drawn up. In case of a loss suffered by the injured, he or she can recover from the insurance company the actual amount of the loss or the amount of policy, whichever is less. Life insurance. It is a contract under which the insured pays premium periodically. How much the premium will depend upon the total amount of the policy and the number of years for which the policy is drawn up. At the end of the period, the money along with the interest is returned to the insured. When the person who is insured dies, the full amount for which the policy is taken is payable to the person whose name has been nominated by the insured. Unit Trust of India. You can buy units in your name or in joint names from the Unit Trust of India, which is also called as UTI. Each unit has a face value of rupees 10. A minimum of 100 units has to be bought. Every year in June, the Unit Trust of India declares dividends out of its projects. Advantages of investing in units. You get regular interest. You get income tax relief on the amount invested. The dividend you get is completely exempt from income tax. Whenever you are in need of money, you can encash the units by selling them back to the UTI at the repurchase price fixed by it from time to time. You can transfer the units to another person and it is a safe investment. Shares. When private companies want to develop, they float shares to the public. When you buy a share, you become a part owner of the company. You share both the profit and loss of the company. Debentures. Debentures are also known as bonds. When you purchase a debenture from a company, it means that you have loaned the money to the company. Example of debenture is in the picture below. When compared to investing in shares, this is a safer method of investment. You get your interest irrespective of the company's profit or loss. In return, the company promises to pay back the investor not only the amount invested but also a fixed rate of interest on it at regular intervals. Property or jewelry. If you have a large saving, you can buy any one of these and keep it with you. You can sell it at a later date when its price goes up. Disadvantage here is that when you wish to sell off your property, it may take long time to get a suitable buyer. When you sell off your jewelry, a certain amount of loss may be faced in the weight of the jewelry. Now, selection of investment scheme. It depends upon your capacity to save, safety of the investment, the higher rate of interest, easy liquidity, other benefits, the purchasing power, and convenient place of investment. Now, different facilities offered by financial institutions. These are credit card, debit card, ATM card, loan, and e-banking. Credit cards. Most banks provide credit card facility to their customers. This card can be used for purchase of goods and services from selected outlets authorized by the bank. Since this card is made of plastic, it is also known as plastic money. Debit card. This card is issued against your savings bank account. As you make a payment using this card, the money is automatically debited from your account. In this manner, use your money instead of taking credit from the bank. Difference between debit and credit card. Credit card, where you borrow money and therefore a loan. The bank will ask you to pay back the money you spent. If you don't pay back, that you will be charged interest. Debit card, where you spend your own money instead of using from the bank. you don't pay the interest on the amount spent. ATM card. Using a credit or a debit card, you can withdraw money from ATM at any time of the day or at night, 24-hour services. These are located in various places like a bank building, shopping complex, a residential area, or railway bus terminals, etc. Loans. Today, financial institutions provide loans for many purposes like personal use, education, purchase of a house, vehicle, household durables, maintenance, etc. The interest charged by these institutions varies according to the purpose, amount, repayment period, and type of institution, whether government or private. E-banking. Use to know your bank balance, amount of credit available, apply for a checkbook or draft, credit card payments, etc. can be done through e-banking. To purchase railway and air tickets and also pay your telephone, water and electricity bills. To utilize telemarketing facility to purchase goods or to avail services.